a doctor, what is a disease, how a patient is supposed to behave, and so on and so forth. So with this in mind, let's begin our class that will be organized in three different topics. So we will start we will start with an overview about films featuring doctors, and taking a look to different kind of genre of movies that have been produced, which have physicians and medicine as a core topic. And we will try to do some analysis, some considerations about the way physicians and hospitals and diseases are portrayed. Then we're gonna focus on a particular kind of medical movies, medical documentaries, productions that are supposed to be pedagogical tools for example, students, medical students, or for the army. And finally, we're gonna take a look at the movies that are actually used in medical schools today, and what kind of films are displayed to medical students, and for what purpose. This class will be a little bit or very much centered on North American production, just because the movie industry in the United States is not just very productive, but it's world famous. And but we're gonna also add some material which is not from the United States. So let's begin with medical movies and overview. And the first thing that has to be taken into account is that since the beginning of cinema, medicine has been a topic that has been considered as legitimate for this kind of production. And we can find medical movies basically in every kind of genre. We can find dramas. This is a movie from 1991 with, the title is The Doctor, not very original. It's a story of a physician who is, at the beginning of the movie, is a very unpleasant human being. It's kind of cold, selfish, unlikable person with his family, and things with his patients, and things change when he discovered to have a cancer, and he becomes the patient suddenly, and this it's the beginning of a kind of redemption of his character. We have comedies. I don't know if you have you've seen this movie, very funny movie, with Robert De Niro and Billy Crystal. Billy Crystal plays a psychiatrist, which is quite in trouble when Robert De Niro bumped into his office. Robert De Niro is a mobster in the movie. He's a mafioso. And he is completely in crisis, is depressive, and he wants him to be his psychiatrist. And there is also a sequel, but it's not as good as the first one. Yeah, exactly. We have Love Stories. Yes, Love Stories. Well, another movie from the early 90s with Michael J. Fox. The title is Doc Hollywood. He plays a plastic surgeon who wants to become the plastic surgeon of movie stars, and he's traveling to Hollywood, but his car broke in a small village, and he is forced to stay there and to become a kind of little small town doctor, and he eventually falls in love with one girl from this town, and decides to not move to Los Angeles, but to stay with his girlfriend. We have parodies. This is called Young Daughters in Love. Gary Marshall is the director of Pretty Woman. And in the early 80s, he authored this comedy, which is not a kind of a masterpiece. It's a very light, very, very silly comedy, but it features a lot of famous actors, and it kind of mocks the movie, TV series famous in the 70s, General Hospital, and so just to basically it's the same kind of humor you find in Police Academy, but it's in a hospital. We have biopics. This is an example of the story of a real doctor, Hunter, called Hunter Patch Adams. Patch was a nickname. Portrayed by Robin Williams, and it's the story of this physician who went to medical school in Virginia, and he developed quite a critical view on the American healthcare system, on the fact that it's accessible only to people who have financial resources, and he decided to open a clinic which will be deliver healthcare for free to patients who doesn't have any resources. And he also decided to use humor as a therapeutic device. So he show up in the world wearing a false nose like a clown, or oversized shoes, and he basically shows that having a sympathetic and relationship with patients, and using humor to dramatize their condition, it's actually have a therapeutic values. He was also criticized a lot from the medical profession, from his colleagues. Actually, it's from a book, but critics didn't really appreciate this movie, but it had a huge success in theaters. We have adaptations from work of from books, from literary work. Well, this is most probably one of the most famous movie adapted from a literary work from the book by Boris Pasternak, Dr. Zhivago. The story of this physician whose life will be completely who lives during the First World War and the Russian Revolution. We have war movies. This is a quite recent movie. Maybe you have seen it. Hacksaw Ridge. It was nominated at the Oscar. It's been directed by Mel Gibson. It's the story, the true story of a military doctor who decided to volunteer for during World War II in the US Army, but for religious reason he refused to carry any weapon, and which in a war in a war zone, a war front could be kind of a problem, but he managed to fulfill the work of a war doctor, eventually being also wounded, and he was decorated with the Medal of Honor of the Congress, which is the highest kind of decoration that a civilian could be bestowed by the Congress in the United States. It's quite a gruesome. It's an interesting movie, but there are some scenes that you actually can see the guts of people in the first displayed before your eyes. It can be quite disturbing. We have horror movie. This one of the earliest example, The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. Do you know this movie?
Just yeah.
Sorry?
Yeah.
Well, it's from 1920s. It's a German movie. It's considered one of the most typical example of German expressionism. It's a silent movie, black and white. And it's the story of this psychiatrist, which has kind of portrayed as a mad psychiatrist, who hypnotized one of his patients and forced him to commit murders. We have science fiction. Yes, Doctor Strange is a doctor. He is a brain surgeon. As you might know, he's had a car accident, and he's broke his hands, and he cannot operate any longer. And he decides to take up some classes of magic in order to eventually feel useful again. Well. We have movies that are set in hospitals. The first one, actually, we have already briefly talked about it during the class on mental illness. Someone Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest is an adaptation from a novel. And it's entirely, well, basically the most majority of the film is the interior of a psychiatric asylum. And it's a kind of what is called a weak law. It's a closer space in which the dramatization of the movie is given from the relationship between the inmates, between the patients, and between patients and the fighting with the character played by Jack Nicholson. And it's an interesting movie for several reasons, because we do not see as much the physicians as we see the chief nurse. And so there is also the question of the relationship between genders. You have the most majority of the patients are men, and there is this powerful woman who is in charge of them and is in a position of power in compared to them. The other is a French movie, The Officer's Ward, and it's the story of a friend, French officer of World War One who is injured at the very beginning of the war in the summer of 1914. He's hit by a bombshell in the face, and his face is completely disfigured. And basically, he spends 4 years of the war into a hospital, receiving several surgeries in order to reconstruct his face. And this is a movie which is historically accurate because the reconstructive surgery was one of the field of medicine which was particularly stimulated by World War One, and because of the particular kind of injuries that that soldiers suffered in this during this conflict. And the entire movie is has been shot into a French hospital, which now is no longer a hospital, but you have the archives of the military medical service, the French military medical service. It's called Val de Grâce. And basically, it's the relationship between the patients and the physicians and the several operations that these men are have to receive in order to eventually recover a recognizable face. There are some cases where physicians are decided to not be just physicians but also directors, and this is a case of a French physician director called Thomas Lilti, who I'm not sure that he is still working as a physician, but he is the author of several movies well received both by the critic and the public that displays the medical profession. So the first one called Hippocrate, I left the titles in French. It's the internship basically of a young medical student in a Parisian hospital, and the fact that this young student is the son of a very reputed and powerful physician is one of the topics of the movies of the plot, and he works with a grown-up an experienced doctor which is forced to do the same job as him and to be a trainee basically because he's not a French citizen. He has a doctoral degree from Algeria and is not fully recognized by the French medical system. The second, that basically he makes one movie every 2 years, the Médecin de Campagne is the country's physician. It's the story of a country physician which is because of cancer that he has is incapable of working by himself and is forced to get the help of a former nurse who eventually went to medical school, and even if he's not very very young, he's just at the first experience of practicing medicine. The third one is called The First Year, and is about the first year of medical school in France. Basically, if you are in France and want to become a doctor, you after high school you can enroll medicine without any exams to be enrolled, but at the end of the first year there is an exam, and if you don't pass it, you are not allowed to pursue your studies. It's a very very selective exam, and the story basically is two students of the first year who are working to prepare this this exam. But so basically a lot of different genders and different ways in which the work of a physician and the experience of practicing medicine can be portrayed and displayed. But if you want to get a little bit deeper and to see what kind of characteristics can we can observation we can do by considering the way physicians have been portrayed in movies, we can start with by saying that well, if movies portraying physicians are exist basically from the beginning of the birth of cinema, the number of movies portraying a physician is in the trend in is a progressive trend. The number of movies display portraying physician is constantly increasing. We have in the 1920s just one movie. We're talking about American movies portraying physicians, and an average of 45 movies in the 1990s. If we want to make a statistic about the kind of genre which is most frequented by frequently used to portray medicine and physicians. Well, basically, the half of the movies is are drama, followed by comedies and horror movies. These are data from a study that has been conducted on movies produced in Hollywood from the early 1920s to the end to the beginning of the 2000. For considering the kind of doctor which is portrayed in this movie, well, if we want to break down according to the different specialties, the most majority of the doctors are surgeons, followed by psychiatrists and general practitioner. Basically, we can find every medical specialty that at least has one movie in which a representative of one specialty is portrayed. Some specialties are more represented than others. For instance, for some reason there are little number of pediatricians portrayed in movies. This is a question without an answer. We find a staggering gender imbalance. The average physician portrayed in only by Hollywood is a man, not a woman. And this, there has been some decades in which female doctors were completely absent from the scene. Just male doctors were considered, just men were considered appropriate figure to portray a doctor. The number of movies displaying female doctor grow up in between the end of the 60s and all the 70s, and then starting from the late 80s and in the 90s, the numbers started dropping again. For a series is different. For if you take a look at the movie at TV series portraying medical-themed TV series, they are more attentive to the balance between between female doctor and male doctor, which makes sense because basically, if we take a look at the statistic about the students who enrolls every year medical schools, there are more and more women, and this trend basically started in the 50s, 60s, and has always been growing. So there is no reason why it's unrealistic, the fact that of depicting physicians just as male. One movie that is considered kind of the first to address this question of women in medicine and in a positive way is this one, The Interns. Movie from the early 60s, in which a chief surgeon played by American actor Telly Savalas, who was famous for being the Lieutenant Kojak in famous movie series, it happened that he has a female student, a female doctor, which would like to enroll his internship. At the beginning of the movie, he's very unpleasant and direct with this female student, saying women are not supposed to, women in medicine are a disruptive presence because the fact that they do a job which is a job made by men has dangerous consequences in the family. But eventually this female student proved herself being extremely skilled and extremely talented and conscientious, and he eventually, this chief surgeon, changes his mind and accepts her as an intern in his internship. We find also an ethical imbalance. So the average Hollywood doctor is male and white, staggering white, at the point that it's basically meaningless try to make a statistic about other ethnicity than white, because even today 91% of physicians on the big screen are white. This also is something that the percentage changed through history. We have a moment in the history of medical movies in Hollywood in which this percentage, the percentage of non-white physicians, grew till the 15% in the 1960s, but then started dropping again. Once again, series are different. If you take a look at the cast of medical team series, which are now on Netflix, for instance, they're more attentive to diversity. You find African American doctor, Asian American doctor, female Asian American doctor, and so on and so forth. Yes, it might sound artificial, but the question is, if you look at how, if you step in a medical school in a university in the United States, you do not see this kind of whitewashing. You can see the in college, in medical school, students which are not the imbalance, the ratio between the different ethnicity is definitely not what it is portrayed in Hollywood movies. And once again, a movie that for the first time addressed this question directly. Guess who's coming to dinner? Do you know this movie? Yeah, it's this nice pretty lady coming from a WASP family, white Anglo-Saxon Protestant family, once decided to introduce her fiance to her parents, and her fiance happens to be Sidney Poitier, who plays a physician, African-American physician. And it's kind of shock for her parents. So this kind of plot now it would never be possible in Hollywood because mentality and sensitivity toward toward racial issues have changed. You can see Audrey Hepburn in the playing the mother. So another thing, the average American the average Hollywood doctor is male, is white, and is young. The most majority of the physicians are in their 30s, let's say. How are they portrayed? Half of the movies, a little bit more than half, portray physicians in a positive light. They are the good guys. They are respectable and decent men. Especially the movies in the 40s and 50s, the physician is the hero, is an inspirational figure, is someone who you can trust, is someone who is committed, a moral, devoted person, eventually faithful to his wife, a very good father for his children, and so on and so forth. From the 60s, we start having more and more bad doctors, doctors who are the villains, but in and different kind of villains. So once again, if you want to break down the kind of vice, the kind of default, it's proper to these bad doctors. There is the figure of the mad scientist, like the Dr. Caligaris, for instance, the Mr. Hyde that becomes the Dr. Jekyll. Dr. Jekyll is a good guy and then becomes a kind of mad murderer. 7% of the physicians are depicted are unpleasant figure because they are selfish or they are greedy. So they have chosen to become doctors not for helping people in distress, but just to make money. Another 3% are negative figures because they are cold, they are detached, they are not human. Starting from the 1990s, a new kind of plot has been introduced in Hollywood. Movies that become that start with the physician being an unpleasant figure, and then something happens, an event, an accident, a romance, or a tragedy, and this unpleasant physician changes his mind, changes his behavior, and becomes a good person. Just like the first movie that we have mentioned, the Doctor. It's an example. After he has been diagnosed with cancer, he becomes humble, he becomes sensitive, empathetic, and so on and so forth. Yes. 30% of movies displaying medicine and doctor are scientifically inaccurate. Inaccuracy can come from the fact that they do not portray the medical profession as it is, or they provide medical inaccurate information about portraying, diseases, for example, with the wrong symptoms. For example, there was a movie in the middle of the 90s called Outbreak. It was about a mutation of the virus Ebola spreading and menacing a small town in the United States. And eventually, military physicians succeeded in find a monkey who is carrying a kind of vaccine for this virus. And in the movie, basically, they just using one lab monkey, they obtain a vaccine that eventually will save the city. Well, a vaccine is not obtained just pulling some blood from one lab monkey. The process is a little bit more complicated. So, but this also tells us that if 30% is kind of a high percentage of inaccuracy, the chances of people being influenced by a misleading depiction of medicine is quite high. But let's take a look at a very particular kind of medical movies, because if we talk about documentaries with medical team documentaries, we can think at one of one movie we have also talked about during the the class about movie medicine and the media, Michael Moore documentary called Psycho, which is a critique against the U.S. medical the U.S. healthcare system, but there is educating citizens. So this kind of movies actually began in at the beginning of the 20th century. In the U.S., the first movie theater opens in 1905, and in 1905, we have the first medical documentary, which is distributed in theaters. And in just 2 decades, 1,300 medical movies of this kind are produced. Well, you need to take into account that in the early 20th century, people, if you enter a movie theater, you didn't see just one movie that like today. You will see one documentary, one newsreel, one movie, and then another documentary. You could stay basically the whole day or the whole afternoon inside a movie theater and watching several different things. And most of these movies were created for being displayed in schools to educate children, or to educate soldiers in the army just before and during the war. And they cover topics like hygiene, for example, teaching, recalling students, children, that they have to brush their teeth, to wash their hands before eating, about contagious diseases, especially in the army, venereal diseases, tons of documentaries about syphilis, birth control, and mental illness. And it was a quite profitable industry, because involved in the production of this movie, there were not just directors and producers and actors, but physicians, journalists, owners of movie theaters, and people really enjoyed this kind of movies. I have some clips to just make you give you a taste of what this was like. This is a very inspirational documentary called Men of Medicine, sorry, this misspelled, of the 1938. This is just all this. You can find the old clip on YouTube if you are curious. Let's see if it starts. The music is inspirational.
Yeah.
In every U.S. city and town, there is one house that everybody knows, the doctor. Available here are the services of a man who, by law, is privileged to practice the most respected of all professions. Will today's 155,000 men of medicine have come a vital trust to heal the sick and keep the healthy well? and to the nation's 69 schools and academies. It entrusts the responsibility of passing on unbroken the inheritance of medical knowledge, of indoctrinating each young student with the traditions and ethics of this chosen profession. Here we must spend 4 long years. Here we must learn every physical detail, every living function of the human body. He must master the science of chemistry and biology. He must train his mind to grasp and make use of the accumulated knowledge of 20 centuries of medical research. And with his degree, Doctor of Medicine, he takes for himself the age-old hope of his profession, the hope of democracy.
The good old time where physician medical students were smoking cigarettes. I don't know if you noticed when they are sketching organs from anatomic pictures. There is one student who is smoking a cigarette. This is another example. This was a documentary produced for the army during World War II. To the people of the United States. It's quite long, I think it's like 30 minutes more or less. I cut two clips to show you. I don't know if you can raise the volume, maybe. Let's try.
Surgeon General of your Army, I know that the subject of this film is a deadly enemy and a menace to our armed forces. For too long, we have allowed a social taboo to prevent effective discussion and action. Now, it is high time. We met the enemy with all the force and knowledge at our command. I am sure that Dr. Parent agrees with me.
I completely agree with what General Kirk has told you. The lifeblood of a democracy is your ability to understand and act upon a problem once the facts are presented to you. The purpose of this motion picture is to give you the facts, and then you, as individuals and citizens of a democracy, must take action.
So this introduction, and so they are addressing to soldiers, actually. They haven't specific about what it's about. There is a kind of a little dramatization. There is a little story which is presented in order to better display the topic. And what's happening?
To visit their women. Okay. I kept her out. The crew was all backed out. You didn't have to work fast and get you back into action.
Action?
I know I'm too fine for good. I know I'm headed out of an asylum and a CI dog. I wouldn't mind it so much getting the worst from a Messerschmitt or a Zero. If I had a couple of good books at him first. Captain, I would try to tell you how to handle baby things. If I send me out to run my business.
What do you mean, sir?
I mean, you don't know a thing about syphilis, except a few girls. Oh, they take it over the animal before you start dropping bombs on me. They're the surface germs, the spirochetes. They run into your body tissues, but you want to kill them before they do any harm.
Before they do any harm?
That's what I said. Medical science has developed a specific cure for syphilis. Anytime you can find them early, you can cure it. And the earlier we find it, the quicker the cure. And you caught your case right at the start.
But I've always heard
the moon. The kid next door, the patent medicine salesman? Sure enough, for anyone to know what he was talking about.
Colonel, give me the works. I've got to get back to that big plane. When was that treatment?
We start today, because you have syphilis. So, this kind of, really there are tons of documentary about syphilis, which is considered an enemy as just like dangerous, like as Germans for US troops. And the way the disease is depicted is really like it was an enemy that that the U.S. soldiers, as soldiers, need to fight as a patriotic as a part of the patriotic duty. This is another example of another kind of documentary, which is kind of different, both from the formal viewpoint, because it's not with actors, and from the public to that was intended for. And no, you can even find the most beloved Disney character enrolled for this kind of educational movies, Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse, and this was an educational movie for girls. But let's take a look at what actually medical students are exposed to now in medical schools that are no longer have recognized, acknowledged the not just the legitimacy, but the how movies can be an effective tool for teaching. And the kind of the movies that are showed, that are displayed to medical students, are used to make them think about some issues of their profession, some questions that they will be called to answer to when they graduate. Some problems that they will encounter on a daily basis or in a particular specific working set. Some movies are intended to address the question of the self-determination of the patients. So, as we know, medicine have stopped to be a paternalistic discipline. A physician is not supposed to treat his patient as they from a top-down perspective anymore, but the principle of consensus information and consensus and the autonomous decision of the patient has become the leading principle for the patient medicine physician relationship. So some movies are intended to address these questions, and within what Hollywood is offering, there are pictures that are particularly interesting for this purpose. This one, for example. I don't know if you have seen this movie, Million Dollar Baby. It's about the story of a girl is a woman in her 30s that she's a waitress, but she would like to become a professional boxer, and she's trained by Clint Eastwood, a professional boxer trainer, and eventually she becomes capable of competing for the world title on his weight category. But during a match, she's injured and she becomes quadriplegic. She basically is capable just moving her head, and her entire body is paralyzed. And she would like to end her life, but she can't. And eventually, her former coach help her to finish her life. This movie basically presents the choice of ending of euthanasia as a good choice. The life without boxing for the character played by Hilary Swank is meaningless, and her coach, who in the movie the name of his coach is Frankie, who decided to euthanize his former student is presented as a hero, someone who is if he broke the law of the United States and the law of his own consciousness, because he would like her to live. But the fact that the choice of one patient to not receive medical treatment anymore, because he or she is in a critical condition. This is a question that physicians are frequently exposed to during their profession. And if a movie is displaying in a positive way the choice to die can raise questions and stimulate discussions about this issue. Just the same thing can be done also by a movie that actually chooses a different pattern. This is from a true story of Jean-Dominique Bobet, who was the chief editor of the magazine Elle. And when he was 43, he had a car accident, and he had a stroke and a car accident, and he went in hospital and was diagnosed with a condition which is called the locked-in syndrome. Basically, it's like if you are completely conscious but you can't move any part of your body. You are locked inside your body. And in the movie and in the real world, the only part of the body which was not paralyzed was his left eyelid. And eventually, thanks to a speech therapist, he learned to communicate like a Morse code with his eyelid, and even be able of dictating an autobiography, which has been published and just a few months before he died in a hospital. But one of the first scenes of the movies is he in hospital trying to communicate with his eyelids, and he's a speech therapist trying to understand what he's saying, and what he's saying is, I want to die. And the speech therapist in her first reaction is to yell to him, how do you dare? How you dare dying? How can you be so selfish? There are a lot of people who loves you. You have a son. You have friends. You have colleagues. And this is considered from the viewpoint of the medical ethics to cross the line, because a physician or a healthcare professional is not supposed to tell a patient what he's going, he has to do. It's just his work is just to inform him about what is the situation, what are the options, what are the what is the diagnosis, what if the prognosis, not to behave in this way, even if it is understandable. This movie eventually displays the choice to live, even if in this terrible condition, as the positive choice, as the right way to behave. Just as the movie that we were talking about before, Million Dollar Baby, did the exact opposite thing. Another question that is addressed in medical schools with using movies is the relationship between medicine and the law. So what a physician is supposed to do, for example, if to compel to obey the law, he is forced to broke the confidentiality agreement with a patient, or what he's supposed to do if the law tells him to do something that from the medical viewpoint is wrong. This is frequently the case. For example, this is another true story, Vera Drake. It's a movie who had the Palme d'Or at the Cannes Film Festival. The story of an English woman, a working class woman in London in 1950s, who worked as a cleaning lady for the upper class. And she also performed illegal abortions with a pretty safe procedure, and for free, just to help women who didn't want to a pregnancy come to an end. The plot is about one of her let's say patients who has a problem after receiving an abortion and eventually goes to the hospital, and the physician who treats her is he knows that her patient has an illegal abortion, and he questioned what he's supposed to do, because according to the law, he was supposed to call the police. But according to the confidentiality agreement with the patient, it will be unethical for the physician to violate this secret. And what the physicians do eventually is to persuade the patients to go herself to the police to denounce this woman. And eventually the question of what are the limits of the pressure that a physician can exert toward a patient is discussed. What is the difference between a dialogue and a pressure and manipulation? Physicians are always in a position of advantage and power toward their patient, because a patient is by definition someone who is fragilized in her spirit or in spirit or body, and it's easy for a physician, if he wants, to persuade the patient to behave in a way or in another. This is why it's so difficult to decide what is the most deontological way to behave. And another example is the most recent movie. This is, was distributed just 1 year and a half ago. It's The Children Act. Is once again from a true story and from a novel by British writer Ian McEwan. That is a story about a 17-year-old boy who is from a family of Jehovah Witnesses. And he's sick and he needs a blood transfusion, but according to his family's religion, he couldn't receive blood from other persons. But he's underage, he's 17, and eventually the movie is set in England. English law says that a 17-year-old boy is not capable of making autonomous decisions, so it's the state that decides for him. And eventually the judge who is in charge of this case, which is played by Emma Thompson, decides that he needs to be transfused of blood, even if he doesn't want. But when he turns 18 and he needs another transfusion, then he is legally authorized to refuse and eventually to die because he didn't get this kind of medical procedure. So if you are a doctor and you know that you with a blood transfusion you could save your life, but the law says that you need to let the patient do whatever he wants, what do you do? Do you go against the law? Do you go or you act according to the law, even if from a medical viewpoint acting this way is procuring harm to your patient, which according to the Hippocratic oath you shouldn't do in the first place. Another issue that is addressed in medical school concerns the, let's say, personality troubles that could develop eventually in physicians, because what's happened if a physician develop a narcissistic personality, which is something that can be at certain level pathological, but at a small level can be equally harmful for the relationship between patient and physician. And a movie which portrays this case very well is called Malice, and it's about a couple, happy couple played by Bill Pullman and Nicole Kidman, which is eventually completely disrupted because of a narcissistic physician, a friend of the character played by Bill Pullman. This is to recall physicians, medical students, that all the knowledge and that they acquire and the position that will fulfill in the society and their profession. Always they have to recall to remain humble. They need to not overestimate their knowledge and their position, because otherwise they will not be capable any longer to do what a physician is supposed to do. Another topic which is treated by movies is the conflict of interest. This is a movie adapted from a series called The Fugitive. It's the story of a physician who discovered that one colleague of him wants to patent a medication which is supposed to be helpful for heart diseases, but is has very serious side effects on the liver. And this other physician, who is tied to Big Pharma's company, decides to hire a hitman and eventually kill his colleague. He doesn't succeed, he kills the wife of his colleague, who is eventually sent to prison because he is suspected to have killed his own wife. And he eventually escapes, and he escapes and wants to demonstrate that he has been framed, and it is his colleagues who is acting against the law. But the question of how do you behave, how do you set a limit between the how do you set your relationship with the pharmaceutical companies for American doctors is a question that they have on a daily basis. They meet every week basically with a representative from the pharmaceutical companies that sometimes offers them sometimes they offer them bribes. This okay, it's illegal, but what if they offer just samples of medications or free lunch? They do this. They come to medical cabinet with a free lunch every week, or maybe several times a week, or free tickets for a conference. Is Las Vegas, which is this ethically inappropriate to accept this kind of gifts? This is something that a physician should think about, because the aim of big pharma's company is not just or in the first place to produce medications that are helpful, but to produce medication that they can sell. And if profits is the first aim, then to be extremely vigilant at the way they tied their stamp to big pharmas. Questions about ethics of experimental research are also portrayed in movies. An example is this movie from the early 90s called Awakening. It's the story of a physician played by Robin Williams, who plays a dramatic character for once. He works in a hospital where people are in a kind of coma, and he tried a medication that eventually can wake them up. It works, but it has a lot of side effects, and he is portrayed as someone who is acting not driven by pride or selfishness, but just because he wants to do the right thing. He wants to help these people. But what if the desire of helping the others led to use, for example, a drug which is not fully cleared by the research procedure, that can be helpful but also can cause damages? The question of professional boundaries is also addressed in movies and in medical schools. Two examples, a comedy and a drama. The first one, Waitress, which eventually became a musical in Broadway, the story of this young and attractive waitress in a small town in the United States who is not just capable of baking delicious cakes, but is also married with an unpleasant and emotionally manipulator husband. When she got pregnant, she goes to the doctor, and she brings a cake to the doctor, and she tells the doctor that she is kind of troubled when she sees him, and she kisses him. So it's not the physician who breaks the boundaries between the physician and patient, it's the patient. But the question is, for example, if you're a physician, how do you behave if one of your patients brings you a gift? This can happen, for example, in a small town when the physician is considered someone who is part of the family, or who you're supposed to be grateful for the help that he or she has offered. and a patient brings a cake to the physician. Do you accept or not? Well, it's might seem an irrelevant question, but it's about how do you frame the relationship between the professional relationship. And if in this case there is no question of sexual misconduct, but if you are a physician and you fall in love with a patient, are you supposed to stop being the physician of this patient, or you can keep going? Well, this, from the viewpoint of the medical ethics, is a no. If you are a physician, you're not supposed to treat your partner, your husband, your wife, the members of your family. If you are a surgeon, you do not operate your children. You do not operate your parents. This is something that physicians are not supposed to be doing, because the personal involvement is so high that the risk of mistakes, medical mistakes, is really, really high. The other movie is with and by Denzel Washington, who plays a Navy psychiatrist who has as his patient a man called a young sailor called Antoine Fisher, who is a violent guy, abused as a child, and they develop a relationship like father-son relationship, like parents to a son. And this is something that is not supposed to be happening in a professional relationship. There is a scene, for example, in which the doctor gives his home telephone number to his patient and tells him, you can call me anytime, day and night, which sounds nice, and if you want, sign of a sincere commitment from a physician. But the physician is not supposed to go to this at this level of confidentiality. Just like a physician is not supposed to disclose personal information, events of his own life, especially if he's a psychiatrist. Humanitarian emergencies, another topic that well, it's not the let's say on what a physician can be confronted to on a daily basis, but there are physicians who decided to, for example, work for Medicine Without Borders, to work in difficult work set, different reasons, from the sanitarian, because there is a sanitarian emergency, because the political frame is troubled. And an example is this. A movie called The Last King of Scotland is set in Uganda in the 1970s, and it's a story of a young physician who is very committed, very he considers he being a physician is a calling for him, and he wants to work in this difficult set. But when he arrives, he realizes that he's unprepared for this kind of job, both professionally, because he doesn't know how to deal with the local medical sanitary conditions. He doesn't know, for example, according to the fact, considering the fact that the resources that he has are limited, the choice between delivering basic healthcare, basic medical help to a considerable number of the population, or to give high quality and medical help just to a small but more in need part of the population. Eventually, he befriends with the president of Uganda, which is a mad dictator, becomes his personal physician. He believes that the president of Uganda is played by Forest Whitaker, and he believes to be the last king of Scotland, to have a Scottish heritage. And eventually this young physician becomes co-responsible of the death of a lot of local people. In the movie, he has also an affair with the president's wife, and eventually he managed to escape from a country on the verge of the war, thanks to the sacrifice of one of his colleagues. So, even if the ways doctors are portrayed in Hollywood by Hollywood is fiction in the majority of the cases, and the effects of the dramatization primes to the accuracy of the reconstructions, they actually can raise questions that the medical students, might have not been thought about in the first place, and be the an interesting way and an effective way to introduce a debate, a professional debate, accurate, factual, scientifically accurate debate about medical ethics, medical medical behavior, medical conduct, and so on and so forth. Okay, we have a few minutes for questions. If you have,
did you watch the film 1+1, Intouchables?
Oh yeah,
Untouchables.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for.
No. Well, I watched it in the French version, the original, and the remake they've done in the United States. They made a remake called The Upside, with Kevin Hart and Bryan Cranston. Bryan Cranston plays the paraplegic man, and Kevin Hart, his life assistant. In France, the movie has a huge success. It was also received the French Oscar, the César, for best actor, and he had nominated in different categories. I personally found really enjoyable, the remake was definitely not good. Yeah. But yes, I find it really, and this is about from a true story, from the autobiographical book of Philippe Pozzoliborgo, who is still alive, a tetraplegic, wealthy man from a family, the family Pozzoliborgo, it's from Corsica. And they have, in the 19th century, they were state officers of the King of France, so it's really, they have really old money. And this is in the title of the book is called the Le Second Souffle, which means the second breath. And it is the real story of the relationship between Philippe and his life assistant, who was a man from Morocco, I think. I didn't know that it has been distributed even here.
What is your favorite movie or TV show about
Dr.
House?
No, for TV shows, I think for TV shows, probably The Nick, because it's a movie about history of medicine. a movie series by Steven Soderbergh, and it is historically accurate. The way the medicine in New York is depicted in the beginning of the 20th century, the hospitals, the physicians, the instruments, it's there is not inaccuracy from this viewpoint. Well, for the movies, I Well, another movie which is I've not talked about here, but is it's actually used in medical school. It's called Mar Adentro. It's a Spanish movie with Javier Bardem, who plays a tetraplegic man who got an accident when he was 26, and he remained paralyzed from the neck down. And he advocated for the legalization of euthanasia in Spain. He became a writer. Well, he dictated his poems, and the movie is really really emotional, and the performance of Javier Bardem is outstanding. In the performance in which he's immobile, basically.
How it's called again?
The Spanish title is Mar Adentro. It means the sea inside. I don't recall exactly how it has been translated in English, but it's very possibly that is the sea inside. Okay, so thank you so much, and we see in 2 days. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Hi, the last lecture will be.
Yeah,
I'm gonna miss.
Well, you can watch it on YouTube. Because all the lectures are recorded.
No, I mean I'm gonna miss your course.
Okay. Oh, thank you. I hope I have the possibility, well, to deliver other open courses and to have you as my students here next year.
Yeah, I hope I will be there too. Have a good night.
You too.
There's no checklist today, so.
Oh gosh. This is not good. Just a second.